So you may be surprised to know that the internet is 50 years old. And the reason we began the ARPANET at the time, which emerged into the internet, basically was to support research centers across the United States, each of which had created unique and individual capability. And we wanted to share each other's resources. And the idea was to create a network which would allow us to log in from one site to another without having to travel. There were unique capabilities, graphics, high-performance computing, database simulation. And so the Advanced Research Projects Agency decided to create a network. So they reached out to the research community who had already developed the technology. I had done my work at MIT, there were some others. And the network came to life in 1969, when the first switch, what you now call a router, appeared at UCLA. That was in September 1969. A month later, the second switch appeared, 350 miles to the north, at Stanford Research Institute. And so on October 29th, 1969, 50 years ago, we decided to send the first message. And all we wanted to do was to log in from UCLA to Stanford Research Institute. To log in, you simply have to type L-O-G. And the remote machine will finish the IN for you, and you're connected. Now, in order to make sure this happened, we had a telephone connection between our group down at UCLA and the folks up at Stanford Research Institute. Now, think about that. We're using the telephone technology to create a new technology which will replace the telephone technology. And it did. So we sent the L, get the L, we got the L. Sent the O, get the O, got the O. Sent the G, got the G, no, crash. So the very first message ever on the internet was lo, as in lo and behold. Now, we were not prepared for media and public relations, but we created the most succinct, powerful, philosophical, and prophetic message you can imagine that existed at that time. The government agency that was supporting and funding this operation was enormously clever about how they did it. They went to a great researcher and said, here's a pile of money. You're going to have it for a long time. Do something great. High risk, high payoff. Failure's okay, but shoot high. And so they gave this money to the researchers they basically trusted. They delegated authority to trusted parties. The researchers took that money and they went to the graduate students. We said, graduate students, we have a job to do. Go make a host-to-host protocol. Go make an underlying IP network. And so we did the same thing. We gave the responsibility to the graduate students. Said, look, here's a lot of money. Here's a task. We're not going to tell you how to do it. Go figure it out yourselves. And by enabling them to use their creative capability, it created a wonderful community. And for almost 20 years, that community was building, curating, developing, and improving the basic internet architecture. Until the late 1980s and early 1990s, when the internet began to reach out to the public community. And now we had enhanced and basically enabled a group of individuals that we did not know. Early on, we knew everybody on the internet, and they were well-behaved. Suddenly, we had people who could reach millions of other users from their basement with a PC at no cost and money or effort, anonymously. Well, that's a perfect formula for great creativity, and a perfect formula for the dark side. And so indeed, we began to see hackers and people penetrating, people trying to spam. And at that time, we considered it a kind of nuisance. Well, the network is sort of in its juvenile years, it's disobedient, it's misbehaving, it'll become an adult. But today we face that situation, we recognize, no, it's not grown up. We now have nation states, we now have organized crime with powerful resources to attack the network for financial reasons, for political reasons, for a variety of reasons. And so I am concerned that that side of the network is a concern. Will it survive this kind of attack? Will we develop tools which will allow proper encryption, proper protection? Because if we don't, the network is going to separate into balkanized regions. And if we get a balkanized network where one site can't reach another site, we'll have a very not open, not free, not shared, not public network. and it will, in my sense, destroy the quality of the internet, which gives us its power. Namely, you can reach everyone, gain information easily, and interchange and collaborate. So what do we expect the network of the future to look like? Hopefully, we will get proper security controls. But this is not easy, because in those early days, we were working with trusted parties. We didn't believe they would misbehave, and they didn't for 20 years. So we did not build in any serious protection against attacks. And to add them at this stage is very difficult. One of the solutions is homomorphic encryption, whereby you can encode the data, encode the programs, and never decode the data until you need to read it. Another possibility is a very different network architecture, where with things that move through the network don't tell you where they came from or where they're going, because those addresses mean a lot to the people who are trying to penetrate. So there's a variety of ways we could look at that. But in terms of the infrastructure, the future infrastructure, it's pretty clear where it's going. We're going to eventually have IoT, highly wireless, mobility, nomadic computing. And the bottom line is we will have basically a pervasive global nervous system on this planet where the internet is everywhere. This room should know I'm here. I should be able to talk to it in English or Italian, a native language, gestures, haptics. Right now, to use this device is much too complicated. Tiny keyboards, new apps. In fact, in the early days, I predicted the internet would be invisible. It would disappear into the infrastructure, just like electricity has. You don't care how it's made, it's an easy interface, and it works. It's not true of the internet. And that will happen with the Internet of Things moving on. So I look forward to that, but the problem that we can't predict are the applications and the services. We've been constantly surprised by things we didn't predict, like email, like Napster, like YouTube, like social networks, like peer-to-peer systems, like the World Wide Web, like search engines. We've been wonderfully inefficient in predicting those major apps. And that's a wonderful thing. We've created a system which will constantly surprise us with new capabilities. And that's basically a formula for the future generation who can provide those applications. There's enormous room for creativity and innovation.